What makes a Jew? Is it a nationality, a race? Can you be genetically tested for Judaism? Or do you need a guilt-tripping mother? It's hard to say exactly, but there is one source that tackles the question, the Bible. Now, regardless of whether you view the Bible as true or not, you can't deny that the Jews are pretty much the main characters. So, what does the Jews' own story say about what makes a Jew a Jew? The Bible starts with the history of everything, starting from the first man, going onward through the flood, the Tower of Babel. All of a sudden, the Bible stops talking about all of humanity and focuses in on this guy, Abram. Yes, I said it right, we'll get to the name thing in a minute. Referred to as Abram the Ivri, Ivri is connected to Ivrit, or Hebrew, the term means he was literally from the other side. Superficially, it refers to living on the other side of the river, but on a deeper level, it foreshadows his iconoclastic nature, a theme that would follow him throughout his life, his legacy, and his descendants, most notably the Jewish people. Much like Pythagoras hypothesizing the Earth wasn't flat and Galileo's controversial teaching of heliocentrism, Abram pioneered the idea that there must be one singular God. Now, at the time, idolatry was the way of the day. You worship a statue over here, bow down to a fig tree over there, sacrifice a child to the big glowing orb thing in the sky, etc., etc. Abram pioneered the idea that maybe all these things came into being because of something else entirely, and maybe killing your virgin daughter wasn't the best way to honor it. And he got really excited about the idea, so much so that he decided to share it. Now, this next part of the story didn't happen in the Torah, it's a midrash. And what's a midrash exactly? Well, think of it like a director's cut of the Torah, a deleted scene, so to speak. Let's just say that what Abram did to his dad's idols was like that Ferrari scene from Ferris Bueller. Though Abram is practically leading a movement by this point, it's not until he was around 75 years old that God actually appeared to him, confirming his belief. Big deal, right? But before he could crack open a bottle of celebratory Bartonura, God's all like, leave your home, your family, and go to this land I'm going to give you. Oh, and you're going to be the father of a nation of people who are going to shape the world. Cool? Cool. Ciao. With that revelation, Abram travels to the land of Canaan. After settling into his new home, he welcomes guests, he fights wars, and he will grow so close to God that by the time his name becomes Abraham, he'll be arguing with him. He's really going to nail that Ivri from the other side brand that he's built. Jumping ahead a little, ever heard of the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah? No, not. Yeah. Two, actually five, depending on how technical we want to get, sinfully wicked, idolatrous, and self-centered cities that God decides have had their shot, their moment in the sun, and now it's time to rain fire. Abraham argues with God, insisting that if there are some righteous people there, perhaps the whole community can repent. Unfortunately, there aren't, but he demonstrates that he will go to bat for anyone if there's a chance of redemption. For someone who will have such a buddy-buddy relationship with the creator of all existence, you'd think he'd have it easy, right? Well, so remember back at the beginning, there was this land God sent Abram to? There's a famine, and he has to leave. His wife Sarai gets kidnapped, twice. His nephew is captured in a giant war. And over all those years, his wife's not able to get pregnant. What's the deal, God? Wasn't being the father of a new nation devoted to ethical monotheism kind of the whole point? God said it would be a rough ride, but throw a patriarch a bone here. Sarai starts to lose patience, you know, being more than a couple decades past childbearing age, and suggests that maybe Abram should have a child by her handmaid Hagar. Hagar gives birth to Ishmael. It's only after his birth that God comes to Abram and says, Abram, I like your style. I'm going to make a covenant with you. You and I are going to be hashtag best friends forever. I'll also stay close with your many, many children coming soon. Your name is now Abraham. Your wife's name is now Sarah. Learn about the wonderful world of circumcision and get ready to have a child. Sure enough, at the ripe age of 90, Sarah gives birth to Isaac. Happy extended family, right? Well, Ishmael and Isaac didn't get along super well. After a playdate involving an apple, an arrow, and some shaky aim, Sarah realized Ishmael was quite the bad influence and strongly suggested that Hagar and Ishmael find themselves a new home away from home. Abraham found himself between a rock and a marital problems place. Abraham turned to God for advice, and God reveals the most profound piece of wisdom ever known to man. Listen to your wife. Just do it. No buts, always. It was a hard day in the Abraham tent hold, but not to worry. Ishmael would become the father of his own nation, he does just fine. Just when it finally seems like a comfortable status quo has been reached, God comes to Abraham and says, hey, you know your son, your only son, the one you love, Isaac? Go climb a mountain and offer him to me on one of those altars you're so good at building. Quite possibly the most difficult passage in the whole Bible, known colloquially as the Binding of Isaac, rabbis, scholars, and critics have debated the story for centuries. Speaking out against child sacrifice was a large part of Abraham's whole platform. And back with Sodom and Gomorrah, he tenaciously argued with God for some alternative. But for sacrificing his own son, he agrees without question. Now, while some may find this story proof of mindless zealotry, the real message of the Binding of Isaac is about a man willing to take the most precious thing in his life, the thing that only came to him via miracle, and be willing to sacrifice it for the sake of the connection that brought him that miracle. It's complicated. The point is, it's a test, and luckily for us, God stops Abraham at the surgical final moment. Because of this, Isaac's children will have a unique status for all of history. Both Abraham and Isaac were willing to sacrifice everything for God. This pretty much ends Abraham's story, but not before solidifying his role as the father of three different religions. He buys a grave for his wife, who, according to those Midrash stories, died while Abraham was passing his bind Isaac test. Then Abraham heads east, but as his last act in the Bible, he has his servant find Isaac a proper wife. After almost being sacrificed, the Bible doesn't tell us a whole lot more about Isaac. Yet we know that he was the critical piece in maintaining his father's legacy. According to rabbinic tradition, he institutes the afternoon prayer known as Mincha, he redigs the wells his father dug, he marries his wife Rebecca, and they also had trouble having kids. But that's about it until his children come into the picture. So, skip. Finally, Rebecca gets pregnant, and it's twins! Even before giving birth, Rebecca knows there's going to be trouble. The children are born, the first is named Esau, and the second is Jacob. The Bible is concise with their descriptions, but the rabbinic tradition details Jacob as a total homebody, sitting in the house, studying all day. He even likes to cook soup. Meanwhile, Esau is a man's man. Sports, hunting, fishing, murder, pillaging, you know, guy stuff. While Jacob cares about continuing his father and grandfather's mission, Esau was kind of over it. Then comes the day for Isaac to give his sons their blessings. Now, this isn't a wedding toast type of blessing. A bracha from a man of God can give you wealth, prosperity, even redirect your destiny. So for Esau to be one of the head prophets of the Jewish mission, well, given his murderous, lecherous, and idolatrous background, it would have been a disaster. Rebecca saw this and had to put a stop to it. So she had Jacob dress up like his older brother to intercept the blessing. Yep. Even in ancient times, identity theft was a thing. Jacob gets the blessing, but then he's gotta get the heck out of Dodge. Even though Esau didn't care about being head honcho before, now that his brother has it, he's furious. Typical sibling rivalry. Jacob runs all the way to his uncle Laban's house a few countries away. Side note about this Laban character. Laban means white, and as we know, always be skeptical about anyone calling themselves Mr. White. Laban professes to be a holy man, but when he notices Jacob making googly eyes at his daughter Rachel, he knows he's got leverage. He makes a deal with his nephew that if he works for him for 7 years, he can have his daughter's hand in marriage. 7 years comes and goes, and the wedding day finally arrives. Jacob wakes up the next morning to find not Rachel, but her older sister Leah in his bed. Yep, Laban pulled the old switch the bride under the chuppah for her older sister after your nephew has labored for almost a decade trick. Classic. But instead of launching a family war, Jacob agrees to work for another 7 years so he can have Rachel as his second wife. Remember, it's early Bible times, so marrying both of your cousins, who also happen to be sisters, is kosher. For now. Over the course of those next 7 years, Jacob and his wives have 12 sons, and he realizes it's time to return to the land of Israel and face his brother Esau once and for all. He steals away from Laban during the night, taking his family with him. Now, Jacob is a little nervous. Esau is rich, ruthless, has an army, and holds onto a grudge harder than McDonald's over a Yelp review. On the way back, Jacob ends up alone, separated from his camp when he's suddenly attacked by a single assailant in the night. Some rabbinic commentators say this attack was just a robber, others say it was the spiritual embodiment of Esau, his brother, and some even say it was an angel of God himself. Whoever it was, Jacob wrestles with the guy all night. Finally, after besting the attacker, he demands a blessing. Remember what I said about blessings. This isn't an ordinary Gesundheit. The robber slash angel slash God blesses Jacob, renaming him Israel. But wait a minute, isn't that the name of the Jewish homeland? Exactly. You see, it's at that point that Jacob finally realizes his potential because he wrestled with God. And since all Jews would descend from those 12 sons of Jacob, they would be known as the children of Israel. Not just because they know God, or are dedicated to doing his will, or even reading his book, but also because they struggle with him. So what's a Jew? According to the Bible, it's anyone from the line of Jacob, which kind of makes Jews an extended family. Whether a Jew is deeply religious, completely secular, only comes around for holidays, lives at home, lives far away from home, or was adopted, i.e. opting in spiritually through conversion, they all stem from the children of Jacob. A sort of spiritual DNA, if you will. But on another level, to be a child of Israel and not just a child of Jacob, you have to grow. How do you do that? You wrestle with the big ideas and always search for deeper meaning. That's how you carry on the covenant that started with Abraham. Where Abraham's other son Ishmael would eventually sire the religion of Islam, and Isaac's other son Esau would, according to rabbinic tradition, eventually foster and adopt Christianity via the Roman Empire, the line of Jacob is specifically distinct because he and his children would always be outsiders, willing to challenge and wrestle with majority at all costs, as if they would perpetually be arguing from the other side, whether that majority was society, popular opinion, royalty, or even God. So, back to Jacob. After Angel smacked down 1749 BCE, he faces his brother. But by the grace of God, Jacob is welcomed with open arms instead of arms of war, and the two reconcile. With his wives, his 12 sons, and great property in Canaan, Jacob has completed most of his God-given mission to sire the heads of the Jewish nation and believes he can finally kick back and relax. You know, as long as he doesn't show favoritism to one of his kids or anything. Oh, well, who likes musicals? Thanks for watching. Join us next time to see how the Bible deals with sibling rivalry.